So, a couple of things before we get started. First thing is that Examsoft is doing an update. So, everybody needs, especially our home testers, needs to turn on your computers into Examsoft to make sure that it gets updated before Tuesday. Examsoft is updating. Please go on your computers and update your computer. I am recording. Examsoft is updating. Just making sure I'm ready to do that. The next thing is, I got an email from a concerned student about the stress level of everyone in the class and primarily concerning performance concerns. And this particular student was speaking on a class, on behalf of the class, asking for perhaps an additional bonus assignment that we could give extra points for, or something like that. Okay? I have visited at length with my team and with Dr. Hicks and Dr. Crouch, and there are a couple things that I would like to say to them. My first comment is, I understand, my goodness, I don't think I have ever been this far behind in my whole teaching career with just the stress of everything. The changes, the constant changes, the changes in the way we do tests, in the way that I have to prepare tests, the different things. So I do understand, not to mention I've had two very close family members, friends pass away in the last month. And so I too have felt a great deal of stress, and I do relate and understand and get it. I get it. And I have a senior in high school that hates COVID, and she is a major drama queen. So I understand children as well. So that being said, I understand. So here's what we are going to do. We are going to give you two bonus questions on every exam. Okay? I would ask for an additional assignment. I do not want to give an additional assignment. Here's why. We do assignments for the class, and I have noticed that a lot of people go into those assignments, click one or two, click through it real quick, do whatever, and the grades are like an 18, a 20, a 30, a 60. They're not reading the material, they're not doing it, they're just doing it to do it, so they get credit for doing it, okay? On that note, we also have had a discussion, and from this point forward, any assignment that is given to you, whatever grade you earn on that assignment, that's what you're going to get in your classroom assignment. So if you get an 18, you're not going to get a 100 because you did it. You're going to get an 18. Okay? That is changing, and I'm letting you know that so that you are aware. And here's my rationale. I went back at the cardiac test. And those students that did that lesson and did well in it and read it and answered the questions did well on the exam. Those that did not do as well on the exam, and it's almost mirrored with how they did on that exam, that lesson, and how they did on the exam. Not always, but a lot of them were very correlated that way. Guys, we don't give you these assignments just for busy work. We give them to help you. And I'm sorry if it seems like a lot. It really is a supplemental education activity that will help you do well and do better on the exam. I may not be the best lecturer. I may not be able to explain everything. So I give you these assignments that help you so that it can help you explain and learn and get more information than what I can give in my little bit of time of lecture. Okay? So I wanted to let you know those things, and that being said, I did make an assignment today. So you go in today, and it's not due until Tuesday morning at 8 a.m. You have all weekend from today until weekend to do it, till next Tuesday before test. Okay? It's over cerebral dysfunction. I did add some other chapters to this week to give you more information to look at, case studies, those types of things, lesson plans that you can go in and read, but they will not be graded. They'll just be there for you as a resource. If you're a knowing of this person and you need to experience it, case studies are your best friend, okay? Going in and experiencing it as the nurse, thinking as the nurse, okay? There's a lot of you out there that are that way. You need to experience it. We're nursing. We like hands-on. We love practicum, right? It's when we get to put it to work. Being in a case study and doing a case study, that's going to help you to do that, experience it, okay? All right. Any questions? I did go in this morning, and I apologize, but I did get in this morning and answer questions on the discussion board. There was a question here. But while we were working on getting connected, that I would like to address really quickly. And that was about Biden's pulse pressure. And is there a definitive number that we look for that delineates that it's Biden? We can throw out an average number of maybe 60. But what I want you to recognize is to look at trends. Okay? Look at trends. If you have a child's blood pressure that initially starts out as 50 over 90, the next time you take it, it's 45 over 95. The next time you take it, it's 40 over 100. That type of thing, you see that trend of a widening pulse pressure. It may not be at that 60 yet, it might be, but the idea is the trend, okay? And that's what we're going to look for to see. Now, if you're given a blood pressure that illustrates a widened pulse pressure, it will be drastic, 30 over 108, something like that, where you're going to know, oh, we have an issue here. Hopefully, you'll know. That's just the number pulling out of my head, so don't stick to that number. And then the other thing I said was lab values. A lot of times, I'm hearing a lot of stress over lab values. Is potassium 3.5 to 5.5 or 3.5 to 5? Here's what you need to know about that. Okay? If we're going to give you an abnormal lab value, if NCLEX is going to give you an abnormal lab value, it will be drastic or it will be way out of that. So a low would be 2, maybe 2.5, because we know 3.3, somewhere around there is our average on the low end. It could be 2.5. But our high is going to be 6.2, 6.4. It's going to be up there where you're going to say, oh, that's way out of parameter. If it is 5.5, then you need to recognize you're on the high end of that potassium level, and we may need to be reducing the amount of potassium they're getting in their IV. We may need to be looking and assessing for elevated potassium, those types of things, okay? If it's a lab value you need to know on an exam or on NCLEX, it will be out of parameters significant enough that those minor differences between 5.0, 5.3, 5.5 aren't going to be that big of a deal. So don't stress over that. Learn what you learn and recognize that those lab values will be really different. Really out there and high or low. Okay? So try not to get too worked up over those things and don't stress about them too much. It's all going to be all right. Just know your lab values. Whatever book you use or resource, if it's on a test and it's out of whack, you'll know. Okay? All right. So I did answer questions on the discussion board. So those are done. So if you have a question on there, you might take a peek. And if you have any questions about the questions or the answers, be sure to get that to me. The other thing is, like, when it comes to seizures and stuff like that, whether it affects a small part of the brain or all of the brain, be it a partial seizure or a generalized seizure, that really is pathophys, right? more what you need to know is what nursing care do I do for a partial seizure? What nursing care do I do for a generalized seizure? Right? A partial seizure, it might be the same type of thing with protecting them, making sure they're safe while they're out of it. For the generalized seizure, we recognize that's going to affect their entire body, could affect their breathing. We're going to make sure we're monitoring their respiratory status. We're going to be, yes, if they are admitted to the hospital for seizures, we will apply a cardiac monitor. And to make sure that the seizures aren't affecting their heart, or if they have respiratory distress, that lack of oxygen can affect the heart, right? So those types of things are what we're looking for with the cardiac monitor, because those do need to be addressed if we're having dysrhythmias, okay? The airway, because a lot of times they'll clamp their teeth, their jaws will clamp, maybe their tongue will fall back. A lot of times, people that are having seizures may turn blue. And so we want to give them supplemental oxygen. We want to do what we can to be there and maybe suction if we need to. Another point of clarification while I'm thinking about it, I said NG tubes on, no NG tubes on traumatic brain fractures and things like that. I went back and looked at my notes. It's not NG tubes, it's NG suctioning, nasal, gastric, nasal, tracheal suctioning. It's suctioning you don't want to do. You may have to put an NG tube down if they're conscious. You don't want them vomiting, but we don't want to suction down their nose because that adds pressure to their brain. That makes sense. I went back and I was like, I know that's not right, because we do put NG tubes down to keep them from aspirating, to help with that kind of stuff, and maybe to feed if we need to, but we don't suction. So I double checked myself on that, and I apologize for that confusion. It's suctioning, nasal tracheal suctioning that we don't do. Fractures and increased intracranial pressure. We may suction their mouth, you know, but we're not going to do deep nasal suctioning. Because if you think about the other thing too, is if we have some kind of fracture, it can affect the sinuses. And our sinuses connect directly to the brain, because they even do like removal of the pituitary and different types of brain surgery through the sinuses, because there's a hole there. And the other reason is sometimes that can actually, if there is an area that's weak in there, you start suctioning through those sinuses and that area back there, and it can cause a hole to be created where cerebral spinal fluid will start leaking up the nose. So, and because if we've had a fracture of some sort, we've had some kind of major trauma, and so that's probably and weakened that structure. Does that make sense? Do you have a question? Yeah, we'll section if they're unconscious and we see that they're choking, or you know, we see that there's some type of issue with the airway that way, but we don't go down the nose. We don't go nasotracheal suctioning on head injuries. Okay, any other questions before we get started?
I have one question on this bonus test question. Do we know which one are bonus?
It'll be at the end. So number 51 and 52. And they may be different formats. Okay? They may be a new format. They may be a hot spot. They may be, most likely they're going to be a different format of question, so that you get used to some of those newer types of questions that NCLEX can have. Maybe a case study with questions about the case study. It may be matching. It may be, who knows, drop downs. Like we have that other where you have a drop down and you have to pick number one, number two, number three, number four, the drop down. Because we had one of those and people weren't real familiar with how to do that. So that may be what that style of question could be on any test. Any question. But that may be the bonus too.
If we turn it in though, will it show like 40 out of 52, how is that going to work?
Yes, that's what it's going to do, because I don't have a way to not score those.
Okay.
But I will go back through and do them independently, and those that got them will get credit for those, and those that don't, they won't lose points.
So the 40, though, would be our actual score test without those two, though?
It's with it.
With it, okay, so we don't really know, though, if we made a 40 or a 38 or...
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't have any way to change that setting on ExamSoft.
Perfect.
Until after the test is over, I can go back and make them bonus questions, but not before.
Thank you.
And it will be that those will be 1-point questions, and everything else will be 2-point questions, so your total test points will be 102. And there's just no way for me to fix that. I tried to make them worth zero, but it wouldn't save. I thought I just made them worth zero, and then it won't count them, but it won't save it that way. It won't let me do it. I tried. Dr. Hicks may come back in and work on that a little bit more, because I did tell her, and she and I both were trying to figure it out yesterday. We spent some time working on that, so I apologize, but that's the way it is. And hey, if you get 2 bonus points, you will get 4 points if you get them both right, not just 2. Okay? But initially, they're only worth 1, just because I want them to be worth 0, but I can't do that. All right, any other questions?
In our book, it breaks down like what types like concussion and fractures and stuff like that. Do you know exactly which one the head injury comes from, or is it just kind of the nurse can for all of them?
Just nursing implications for all of them, teaching, education, those types of things. Really, your focus is going to be the symptoms. What is it? What do I know about it? What are the symptoms? What do I do about it? What do I teach so they don't come back to me? I have an issue with my screen here. Oh no. These are the 4 W's. When you study, it's not the 4 signs of circulation or whatever Mr. Baird's thing. This is for studying, kind of like the nursing process, using the nursing process to study, same type of thing. What is it? That's kind of your patho-phys.
Ms. Heitfeld, we have a question in Tonkawa.
Okay, guys, quiet down.
Those extra points on the test, will they go directly to that test score or to our overall points for the class?
To that test.
Okay, thank you.
Should be. You're on the 27th at 8 a.m. But I opened it where you can see it today. I'm not liking this computer today. What's the issue? Recording. If I go late. I will keep recording. No study session?
Yeah.
Okay. Here we go. Bring my microphone down so everybody can hear me. All right, education. We're talking about seizures. Guys, with seizures, make sure that you're documenting thoroughly, you're keeping track of all of that, and you're maintaining your airway. You are watching your cardiac system as well. Excuse me. We are, if you look at page 1154 in your textbook, 1154, there's box 30.12 that talks about seizure precautions. I would be familiar with seizure precautions. There's also quality patient outcomes also on that page. And that's what we want to happen. That's what all of our interventions are for. We want to see those things. We want to know why the seizures are happening, which is the etiology. We want to determine that. We want to see that they're controlled, at least reduced in frequency and severity. The other thing, guys, is medication. Medication. If you looked at your blueprint, you saw there are seizure medications on there. Be familiar with that. Know your contraindications. Know what you can and can't give it with. Okay? Know what you need to watch for. Most people are successful with one medication. Most, but not all. 60%, so 40%, that's still quite a few, need more than one medication to control their seizures. So know your seizure medications, be familiar with them, know your emergency treatment, know what you're going to do. If you're a school nurse and you have a kid that's having a seizure, what do you think you're going to do? How are you going to help that kid? Right? You're going to go in the classroom. They start to have seizures. You're going to lower them to the floor. You're going to turn them on their side. You might take their vital signs. You're going to make sure that they're safe. If they're sitting in a chair, they're not very safe, right? If they're having a generalized seizure. You want to make sure we turn them on their side in case they vomit. And sometimes they do. So keep those things in mind. Think about, like I said, role play. You see somebody on the sidewalk, a child on that starts to have seizure on the sidewalk, what are you going to do? You're going to help protect their head. You're going to turn them to the side. You're going to monitor and make sure they're breathing. What can you do in that situation? Versus if you're in the hospital and a patient comes in and they're having a, and they've been admitted, a child has been admitted to a seizure unit. Those bed pads will be, those beds, those hard surfaces will be padded. They will have some of those things already taken care of. But you do want to make sure that the suction is set up in the room, right? You want to make sure that you're ready should a seizure happen. What is that going to look like? So think about those things and keep those things in mind. There's a lot of teaching. They have found that the ketogenic diet can help reduce seizures, surprisingly enough. And so you may introduce that to patients and their families. A lot of people have found and been successful with removing and taking out sugar and flour and some of those different things. So the keto diet is basically meat and veggies. Don't have a lot of fruit. Low carbohydrate vegetables, so your high cruciferous, your broccoli, your cauliflower, those types of things. Meat and veggies, basically is what a ketogenic diet is. Sometimes it's high fat. Okay. So you want to make sure that you're managing the seizures. They know what to do at the school. And the school is aware, then what to do at home. We want to make sure that the medications are given as prescribed in an regimented fashion. Can't just stop taking seizure medication, okay? Do not stop taking seizure medications if you have an issue, if you have a side effect, those types of things. You're monitoring your children, you have to call your neurologist and say, hey, my kid's having this symptom, you know, with this seizure medication, and let them take it from there, okay? As nurses, we recognize side effects and we notify the physician, the primary care provider, the neurologist, whomever, and say, hey, there's an issue. Blood levels may be needed to monitor anticonvulsant dosing. Some anticonvulsants are toxic, so we may have to keep track of those. We want to identify possible triggers for the seizures. If it's a flashing light, if it's loud noises, if it's fear, if it's anxiety, if it's whatever, if there are triggers, we want to look for them. Again, make sure the nurses and teachers are informed, and if possible, get them to wear a alert identification bracelet or a necklace or something along those lines. Headaches are not, sometimes happen in children, but they're more frequently in adolescents. There are primary headaches and secondary headaches. There are tension headaches, migraine headaches, and cluster headaches. So if you think about primary and secondary, basically primary is just a headache all in its own. Secondary headache is caused by something else. Okay. Tension headaches can be dull, moderate pain, radiate bilaterally. We all know what tension headaches are. We've all experienced tension headaches. We all live with tension headaches, right? But it can affect your sleep. You can have some issues that way. Migraines are more severe. Typically, it's on one side of the head. It'll have a throbbing or pulsating quality. It can be debilitating. You'll have some photophobia, sweating. They don't like loud noises. Turn the light out, be quiet. Leave me alone, and it's usually on one side of the head or the other. It can precipitate with an aura, or some, and it can also have some nausea and vomiting with it. Migraines are not easily remedied. Those of you who have migraines, you are aware of this. Cluster headaches are unilateral pain to one side, behind one eye, resulting in drooping of that eye, pupil constriction, some redness and edema. You can also have then nasal drainage, nasal rhinorrhea, that's your nose running, with clear drainage, and they don't have an upper respiratory infection. So basically, tension headaches, those types of things, we need to look at lifestyle modification, relaxation strategies. Guys, we teach relaxation strategies. We need to start implementing relaxation strategies in our own lives. I'm one of those that really needs to do that. environmental modifications, anything that we can do. We want to encourage rest, stress reduction, soothing baths, music. I can take some of that right now. It's just, I want a jacuzzi tub though, you know, so not just a regular bathtub. I'm a big old gal and I want to actually get in the water. Moving on. Guided imagery, massage therapy. We may give medications, acetaminophen, ibuprofen. Sometimes beta blockers are used because this helps to reduce the tension in the blood vessels in the brain. Calcium channel blockers, same way. Antidepressants and anticonvulsants. Prevention as best we can. Recognizing triggers, recognizing the auras if it's migraine, and then prophylactic strategies, keeping them stress-free as much as possible, reducing the stress, the triggers, all of that, and then also how to manage the medications. All right, hydrocephalus. By the way, headaches are found on page 1157. 1157 to 1159. In your textbook, 1157 to 1159 for headaches. Hydrocephalus starts on 1159. All right, hydrocephalus. Very bottom. There's a lot of boxes about headaches. interesting information?
So hydrocephalus is too much cerebral spinal fluid in the head. There are two types. Type one is a non-obstructive or communicating. Basically, there's a defective absorption of the cerebral spinal fluid. That's most commonly the cause. The next is possibly an overproduction of cerebral spinal fluid or an issue with venous drainage insufficiency. You don't really need to get into this, just know that there are a couple of different types and it causes too much cerebral spinal fluid in the brain. Okay, don't go too deep into this. It's obstructive or non-communicating hydrocephalus. It's where there's an obstruction of flow of cerebral spinal fluid. And usually that's caused by, okay, so when you think about obstructive, there's too much brain tissue, so tumors, anatomical malformation, cerebral edema. So it's the brain swelling, there's too much tissue, right? So that's obstructive. In other words, it's obstructing, making more pressure on the cerebral spinal fluid, or it appears to be too much because there's so much tissue with the tumor or whatever. So the cerebral spinal, there's too much cerebral spinal fluid for the amount of tissue, brain tissue that's there. Does that make sense? Does that help? Okay. I was getting some looks. All right. So we want to assess. We're going to get a history and physical. Make sure we know any life-threatening issues or signs, conditions, the McEwen sign. We're going to look for that and difficulty holding the head upright, prominent forehead, head enlargement, and a rapid increase in head circumference. We look at the newborns, we look at their fontanelles, right? When we're assessing their fontanelles and sutures, when we're doing that in newborns, it's because we're doing that to see if they have hydrocephaly, if they have an issue with too much cerebral spinal fluid or something that's causing an issue. Okay? And then we'll watch for signs of increased intracranial pressure. If I don't go into what something is, like the McEwen sign, don't fret over it. You can look it up if you want to know what it is. But don't fret over it, okay? I told you what Cushing's triad was, so. So this is what hydrocephaly looks like in a patient at a young child. So now, a lot of times we can see some of this in the ultrasound during the prenatal exam. It is noted sometimes at birth, sometimes it's noted there may be a lumbar puncture that's done. We have to be careful with that. Again, remember, if we have increased intracranial pressure, we don't want to do a lumbar puncture. But with hydrocephaly, what do those kids' heads look like? The fluid is out around, right? It's gone through and expanded the size of the brain. So while they may have some increased intracranial pressure, the reality is their tissues and their brain and their skull has gapped open and allowed for that fluid to expand. So their increased intracranial pressure is not as much because the gait in a child over five, if they start having hydrocephaly, they're not going to get. Their tissue's not going to give. They don't have open fontanelles. They don't have open sutures. Right? So they're going to have increased intracranial pressure. And in one of these kids, when it expands and it gives, it's not squeezing the brain. So it's not increasing that pressure. Does that make sense? So that's why it's okay to do the lumbar puncture. CT, MRI, ultrasound, and the sternogram is another test that they will do to look at the ventricles within the brain and to find out what exactly is going on with the cerebral spinal fluid and how it's flowing through and whether
whether the brain is absorbing it or not and how it's working.
So we want to monitor
and care for any increased intracranial pressure. We're going to measure their head circumference daily. We're going to do what we can to increase the cerebral spinal fluid, acetazolamide and furosemide. We might also give isosorbide to help reabsorb the cerebral spinal fluid. These kids may have to have surgery to place a shunt. What the shunt does is it goes into the brain or the skull, and it goes into the space between the brain and the skull, and it goes down their neck into their abdominal cavity and drains the extra cerebral spinal fluid. So we want to make sure we're giving preoperative and postoperative antibiotics. This can cause some swelling, so again, we need to watch for increased intracranial pressure. Those that have increased intracranial pressure, we want their head to be slightly elevated. We want it at about 15 degrees. We don't want it too high because that can actually put more pressure, and we don't want it low or Kandelenburg because that too can increase the pressure. So we want it right at about 15 degrees. So postoperatively for these children and anyone that has increased intracranial pressure, 15 degrees is about where you want it to be. We're going to monitor that shunt, make sure that it's functioning. We're going to monitor their abdomen to make sure that the fluid is absorbing well within the abdomen. And pretty flat, like I said, this really just about 15 degrees. That's really pretty flat. And then gradually elevate their head once you see that the shunt is functioning properly and everything. And you're seeing a reduction in their circumference of their head. We're not seeing any increase in abdominal girth or signs of anything that way. No signs of infection. No signs of increased intracranial pressure, the vomiting, the headache, maybe an LOC. We're going to provide emotional support to the child and the parent. Again, if this happens at birth, these parents, and that's the other thing I haven't really talked about much, with cerebral palsy, with Down syndrome, with hydrocephaly, these babies, cardiac, congenital defects, these babies are not born normal, or as we like to think when we hold our brand new babies and we say they're perfect. They have 10 fingers and 10 toes and they're perfect. That's our ideal. That's every mother's dream, is to hold their baby and say, perfect. These babies are not born perfect. They have large heads, disfigured. They have issues that are not normal. A Down syndrome baby has Down syndrome. I think they're beautiful, and I think they're wonderful, wonderful children and adults that have Down syndrome. They are a gift, and I think they're wonderful, but they're not normal. They're not perfect. And there's a certain amount of grieving that goes along with that. So go back and reflect on your grieving process. What does that look like? Bargaining, anger, all of those lovely steps. Anytime a child is born with a defect, the parents are going to go through a matter of grieving. Okay? So we want to have some anticipatory guidance. We want to tell them they need to follow up regularly with their PCP. We want to refer them to support groups. Just like with Down syndrome, same thing with hydrocephaly. You want to make sure they know how to transport these babies safely. That's going to look a little bit different. These children will never have contact sports or do anything like that because there's too great a risk with affecting the shunt and their brain, and we just can't have it. You want to teach them the signs and symptoms of the shunt malformation, which is increased intracranial pressure, right? that shunt's not working, or an increase in the size if they're young, and they see an increase in the size of their head. But as the child ages, we'll have a greater chance for signs of increasing the brain of pressure, the vomiting, the headache. They'll have the headache regardless, but yeah. Okay? Cerebral palsy. Dyskinetic, uncontrolled, involuntary rising movements of the extremities, or mixed. So they have both, or a combination of two. A lot of times your spastic will be ataxic as well, just because your muscles are stiff, and so trying to balance, and you don't have flexibility in your muscles, it's not very easy to do, right? So you'll see some of that. So recognize on page 1300, just real quick, the possible risk factors for cerebral palsy are on page 34.1. We don't really know. It used to be they thought that cerebral palsy was caused by trauma during delivery. But they're not seeing that correlation 100%, and so they're not saying that that's the cause. It may be a cause. But it may not be. There's a whole list there of potential causes. So we really don't know. So in our assessment, we want to see what area of the brain is involved and what the extent of the damage is. Some kids with cerebral palsy have a lot of physical issues, but intellectually they're all there. They are right on that, you know, if they're 2 months old, they can do what a 2 month old mentally can do. Physically, no. Mentally, yes. So, look at that. Know the history, prenatal history, the gestational history. If you look at this, there's a lot of issues, and sometimes it comes after delivery. So there may be a brain injury that happens afterwards. Meningitis, encephalitis can cause cerebral palsy. Toxic, traumatic brain injuries, infections, and stroke. Okay, so those are all potential things. And you know, the reality is there can be up to 70-80% of patients with cerebral palsy that we don't know why. We're going to make sure that we assess the muscle rigidity and spasticity. How well can they control their posture? How well do they move? Or do they have lack of movement or lack of balance? Again, we're going to, for lab diagnostics, we're going to look to see what the symptoms are, and we're going to react appropriately. Typically, you're going to see delayed motor development. Motor development. What does motor development mean? Still water. Tell me what motor, oh, I'm here. Tell me what motor development means. Keep walking. So, motor, physical. Motor, what's another? Motor relates to muscular. Good, good, very good. So when we think about motor development, they're not crawling when they should. They're not rolling over when they should. They're not walking when they should. They're not smiling. Smiling takes muscles in your face, right? Which in the child that isn't smiling. Could be a motor development, could be a psychological disability, right? Could be either, but you need to further assess. So, motor development.
You look for those, that's what I told you. Developmental, you need to go back to your growth and development, you know, what your, when a child should walk by, when a child should crawl by, when a child should roll over, when they should smile, all of those things.
Pitchers versus full grass. Are they doing any of that? Are they grabbing toys? Are they not? So, let's say they don't demonstrate hand preference by 6 months instead of more like 12 months. They have the reflexes that persist. Usually, the moro, across extensor reflexes, usually disappear between 6 to 12 months. If after 12 months you're still seeing a moro reflex, we have an issue. Okay.
You said if they have hand preference, this says hand preference by 6 months instead of 12, what are the action movers at their point?
Yeah, what it's saying is most children, just like the first, if you look at the next line too, it says the same kind of thing. It usually disappears between 6 to 12 months. But it lasts longer. In this one, we want, normal would be 6 months instead of 12 months, but in this case, it would be over 12 months.
You're welcome.
Sometimes my typing just doesn't work like it should. Muscular hypotonia or hypertonia. And if a child with cerebral palsy doesn't have, or even when you have poor muscle tone, the Down syndrome kids, the cerebral palsy kids, this is not something that is caused by the parents. Part of their process and their illness or their congenital anomaly that they have, what's going on with them, right? It's not because the parents aren't doing what they're supposed to do, it's just the way it is with this problem, okay? So we will look for that. CT, MRI, cerebral ultrasound, we're going to be looking for malformations, we're going to be looking for damage, we're going to be looking for areas that just don't look quite right, that could be causing these delays. Okay, so cerebral palsy, one of the bigger things is they have a lot of trouble with eating. Think about all the muscles that go into eating, moving your mouth, sucking. Any of that, right? Anything that has to do with eating, so there's feeding problems. You have to watch for aspiration risk. We need to make sure that they're sitting upright 90 degrees when we feed them. We may be doing those swallow studies to make sure. A lot of kids with cerebral palsy may have a lot of drooling. Well, if they have a lot of drooling, there's a lot of secretions that are being excreted. So, and if they have swallowing issues and they have all this drooling, that could cause respiratory issues. If they're not swallowing appropriately, that can cause respiratory issues. Those are all things that we want to make sure we're addressing and we're teaching and we're making sure that the feeding problems are addressed. We want to make sure because some of these kids, like I said, physically may not be there, but intellectually they are. So we need to be challenging them intellectually and continuing to work with them intellectually and helping them to grow. They may not be able to speak because they can't do the muscles that are necessary, move the muscles that are necessary to speak, but they get it. They understand the words. They understand everything. They're right there where a 4-year-old, 5-year-old, 10-year-old should be, but they just can't speak. And so these kids, we look for ways to help address those issues. We get them powered wheelchairs, we give them computer devices that they can just blink or whatever that helps them to communicate. We want to make sure they have a safe environment. We want to use splints and braces. If we're starting to see contractures and those types of things from the flexion and the tightness of the muscles, the issues that they have there, or lack of tone or the overtone, either one can cause issues with balance and with formation. So these patients, clients, a lot of times will have braces on their legs to help support their legs and those types of things. You may have braces or splints on their hands to help with that and also to prevent contractures. We're going to promote self-care. We want these kids to learn to be independent to the best of their ability. Coach them to be the best that they can be. If they can't, we're going to do passive range of motion. We're going to turn them frequently. We're going to keep them clean and dry. Make sure they're sitting up to eat. But we really want to promote self-care. What can they do on their own? We're going to administer medications. There's a whole list there. Can have seizures as well. So we may have to give some phenytoin or diazepam. They have found that baclofen is given through an infusion pump into the spine and it reduces muscle spasticity and muscle spasms. And so it helps them to not live in so much pain and discomfort. Can you imagine if your muscles spasmed all the time? What that would be like. And these kids can have that. So we give the muscle relaxants. We may give the dantrolene. And then the baclofen, that's the one thing that has been found. And there is a surgery that a lot of times is very rare and it's not done very often and only in specific cases. But just know that there is the potential for surgery. But it doesn't really happen very often. The main thing to recognize with these kids is they are cared for the rest of their lives, and they will have these defects for the rest of their lives. It is an ongoing thing. And because they have so many troubles eating, a lot of times these are really skinny kids. We don't want to keep or restrict caloric intake from them. We want them to eat high protein, high fat, high caloric, whatever they can eat, because they're skinny, they can't eat much because of the issues eating, so we don't restrict their calories. And we want to make sure, like I said, we're teaching home care. What do we need to do to take care of them to make sure that they're doing okay? Thinking about potential respiratory complications, thinking about depending on the severity of the cerebral palsy. So prevention includes a lot of decreasing risk factors, infection during pregnancy, premature birth, injury or stresses while pregnant, anything like that that can increase the risk of cerebral palsy, we want to do what we can to prevent it. If you go back to that page 1300 where it has that risk factors, there's a lot of those that we can eliminate or we can decrease. I teach home care, anticipatory diet, and good resources. Sometimes as these kids grow, they do get bigger. And so sometimes, depending on the severity of what's going on, you have to have open lines of communication and assessment of the home environment if the parents are trying to take care of them. And the kids keep coming in with respiratory infections or pneumonia. Or bed sores, or whatever that is potentially they're doing all they can, but maybe they need help. And so we need to provide resources to help them. The best place the child can be is in a loving environment where they're cared for. But we also sometimes need to recognize our limitations as caregivers and as parents. And sometimes as nurses, that can be a very extremely difficult conversation to have, and there may not be a right answer whether they should stay in the home or go to a facility, a group home or something. But having those open lines of communication, exploring resources, and giving them the opportunity to express how they're feeling and their concerns, and not being judgmental in those things is really important. Okay? Neurotube defects. It's a group of birth defects. This starts on page 1310. 1302 has two really good boxes on cerebral palsy. 1302, 34.2 and 34.3, some good boxes there. Again, don't get too caught up in the pathophysiology, look more at nursing interventions. And know the medications that are listed on the blueprint. And really, assessment, 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 assessment. How do you know there's a problem, right? And how do we teach, right? What is it? What do we know about? What do we mean? What do we teach? Pediatrics, that's a big one. Okay, neural tube detects. Moving on. Actually, let's take a break. 5 minutes. 5 minutes.